about this.
I'm just thinking. I know it's in August. Yeah. It's like first or second week.
The professional picture.
Oh, yeah. Oh, good.
Well, say Jamie, so Jamie, he gets $1 for every light and $10 for every share.
Let's circle up.
first report of healing. And then I don't know if you guys also saw, but Maxine was leaving her oxygen tank behind to get up here. You know what I'm saying? I think Maxine put every single one of us to shame this morning running up here. I believe anytime it's the presence of God, anytime it's an encounter with God, that should be who we are. No matter where we're at, we should be running. No matter if we've got a walker, if we've got an oxygen tank behind us, if we were recently healed or wounded, wherever we're at, if it's the presence of God and it's the anointing of God, we need to run to it.
See, that kid
just
fly by me. Just fly.
You know what? I don't know how many of these people were here when, but I had a stroke, and I come in here, I know he knows it, I come in in a wheelchair, and the church gathered around me and prayed, and when I left, I walked out of here. Yes, sir. That was the divine healing.
Let's pray. Father, right now we're coming before you, Lord, thankful. Thankful for all that you're doing and all that you've done in our lives. God, we know without you, we would still be walking in those generational curses. We'd still be walking in those sins. We'd still be walking in our guilt and our shame. And
amen.
We would have no power and no victory.
Thank you.
But it's all because of you and what you did on that cross, Lord.
Yeah, thank you.
God, we're so thankful. God, it's so early, first thing, we're hearing praise reports. There's people that they're just desiring to scream out praises to your name, Father, and to give you glory for what you've done in their lives, Lord. And that's what's so amazing, God. That sees your power, Lord. Not like Paul said, and it's not just about the words, but it's about the power, Lord, that you produce. And you produce that in every single one of us, God. So I pray, Lord, that this morning we'll pour out all of ourselves, Lord.
Yeah.
That we will pour ourselves out as a sacrifice on this altar, Lord, so that you can fill us with your Spirit, and you can fill us with all the glory that you have prepared for our lives, God. Lord, we know that right now there's so much affliction, and even though Paul calls it light affliction, Lord, it's the affliction, but we know that there's an eternal weight of glory, Lord, that's coming.
Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you, Jesus. Father, we want to praise your name. Praise your name, because you are so worthy of our lives. You're so worthy. We love you in Jesus' name.
Can I say something?
Hold on one second. What God's got on my heart this morning is the woman who, she saw that Jesus had came to the Pharisee's house. She came and all she wanted to do was pour herself out on him. She didn't come for any reason. She didn't come for herself. She just wanted to come because Jesus was there, and she knew who Jesus was. And that's exactly what she did. Think about it. She poured out all of her tears. She poured out her hair. She's wiping his feet with her hair. And you've got to understand, this woman, she was a sinner. She was a prostitute. And she didn't, some of y'all women, y'all about getting your hair did. She was messing her hair up, pouring it out. For Jesus, she was pouring out all of her tears, and then that perfume, she poured it out on Jesus' feet. And what we don't realize is that perfume was her lifestyle. That perfume was how she kept herself clean as a prostitute, as her profession. And so when she poured that out, what she was ultimately saying was, "That is not my life anymore. You are." And that's what God is asking of all of us: is to pour ourselves out on Him, just to pour ourselves out on the altar, pour ourselves out completely for Him. If we pour ourselves out 99%, don't expect to receive an anointing. You might receive a gift, but you'll use that gift and you'll always feel empty. Because without the anointing, the gift, it's got effect and it's got power. But you'll always live in regret. Pour yourself completely out. Receive the anointing of God. He's got so much more for our lives than we could ever imagine. Amen.
I just wanted to say that when we look at the book of Acts, when we look at everything everything that's in the book of Acts, dreams, visions, laying hands on the sick, raising the dead, that's supposed to be our life. I mean, if you're a construction worker, you build on a blueprint, right? And we only have one blueprint. We don't have what people say. Our blueprint is in Acts. That's the model that the church fathers gave us. And to say, oh, let's just go ahead and do it this way, because that's not for us today. You know, and that's silly. That's silliness. So we need to get to a place where we expect the healing, where we're expecting it, because he said it was going to happen. He said we were going to lay hands on the sick and they will recover. He said that. You know, he said we would have dreams and visions. You know, can I give a short testimony? I was praying, and back when I first got baptized in the Holy Spirit, I started having visions of people before I even met them. And I would just have clear, distinct things about their face and stuff like that, their clothes. And I was praying last week, and I said, Lord, I don't know why you haven't given me a vision, you know, in a while. And you know, I guess I haven't been the best steward, but if you give me the vision, I promise I'll walk it out. And so the only thing I saw was a long, blonde ponytail, straight hair, long, blonde, straight hair ponytail. And I had stuff to do, so I went to Walmart. And I stood around and I looked for a long blonde ponytail. I checked everybody that walked by. I didn't see the person. The next day, I had a bunch of stuff to do, but it led me back to Walmart. I was actually at Walmart two times that day. And finally, I'm like, I need to eat dinner and I need to get back to go to work. And I was at McDonald's and there was a woman standing to the side of me. And I could tell her hair was up in a bun, but I could tell she had that long, blonde hair. And I was like, oh, boy. So now this is where you have to block out the vision. So I started asking her, I said, well, I pray for you, ma'am, and I just wanted to know that, like, do you need prayer? And she said, actually, yes, I do. My husband passed a year ago, and I'm really having a tough time dealing with that. And so the Lord started to have me to pray for her, and then he started giving me the words as I was praying for her, and that she needed to hear about her husband's passing. And her daughter actually walked up in the middle of that and heard what I was saying to her mom, and she started crying because that was exactly what her mom needed. And when I'm not saying I'm anything special, because I'm not, but because he is no respecter of persons. But we should all have testimonies like that when we come here, because he is alive and he is moving. He is living and he works in us both to will and to do his good pleasure. So let's get to the point where we're not excited about hearing about a healing. We're like, yeah, let's go out and do some more. Let's take it out of the building. Let's take it out to the street and see this. Walk this out and advance this kingdom.
Amen.
Praying to the Father through Jesus Christ, pray Pray through the Holy Spirit. Pray however God leads you. Pray, let the Spirit lead you. If you want to call him Father God, call him Father God, because he is your Father. When I hear stories like that, I get bothered, because I've seen so much hurt in the church. I've seen so many people hurt by the church. So I want you to understand, this is a place of worship. This is a house of prayer. This is a place where you praise Jesus, and this ain't nothing but a building. Okay? This is nothing but a building. But this is where you come to praise his name. And then out there, guess what? You still worship. Out there, you still pray. And without a vision, like my sister was talking about, the people perish is what the Word of God says. It's not the vision, right? It's not the calling that makes us anything special. It's what we do with the calling, and it's what we do with the vision. And that is faith. And without faith, it's impossible to please God. Amen? Also, my sister-in-law, Emily, Stephen and Emily, she went to the hospital this morning. Her water broke, so she's in labor, so keep her in the prayers. Do we have any other prayer requests?
Go ahead, bro.
Jared.
I'm Miranda.
Thanks.
Amen. Amen. Did you get anyone up here this morning? This morning, first time. You do?
No, I've been out here about 7 years.
Amen. So, now, the other tradition that we have is before you sit down, you've got to hug at least 10 people. Because, like Pastor Jim says, you're only a stranger in this place for about 5 seconds. So, everyone get your love on. Amen? Take advantage of it. Right? We come for the music rather than for Jesus and his glory. Francis Chan put it this way. He says, when he hears people say, I like that church, but the worship really wasn't that good, he says he wants you to realize that that worship then, you came for worshiping yourself. What he says is there's angels in heaven, there's these seraphims in heaven, that they are around the throne of God, and it says that they are constantly saying, holy, holy, holy is the Lord God Almighty, who was and is to come. And then the 24 elders around the throne, they kneel down, they cast their crowns in front of God, and they begin to worship. So understand, that's worship. This music, these songs, the lyrics of these songs are beautiful. But it's not about the music. And if you don't like the song, if you don't like how it's played, if you don't like the style of the music, it's not about the music. If the music affects your worship, then your worship was not for God. So, I said it this morning, let's pour ourselves out on the Father. Let's pour ourselves out on Jesus Christ. Man, he poured himself out just like that perfume she poured out. He poured out his blood for our salvation. And man, I don't know your background. I don't know where you're from, but I know where I'm from. And I know my background. And I know the effect that that blood had in my life. So I'm going to make it my goal to praise my God this morning. Let's pour ourselves out. Even Paul, on his way to that chopping block to be executed, he writes to Timothy and he says, I'm ready to be poured out as an offering to my God. If you line that up with Scripture says that we're to be a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable. Now, we might not be going to execution at this moment, but we're called to die to ourselves daily. We're called to be a living sacrifice unto a holy God. So let's pour ourselves out on the Father this morning. Let's pour ourselves out in such a way that we say, thank you, Jesus, for what you've delivered me from. Amen? Amen. Are y'all ready to worship? I didn't ask, are you ready for music? Are y'all ready to worship? Some of you may shaking your hands, clapping your hands, you ain't waving your hands. I ain't gonna shut up until I get everyone in here. Are you ready for worship?
He serves the unfortunate. He regards the Blessed be the name of the Lord. far from above. I've been down to that river. I ain't the same, a prodigal.
Shit.
Jesus. You know, we sing that song, Blessed Be the Name of the Lord, and we've got to understand, man, that's what David in the caves and in the wilderness proclaimed. He says, I will bless the Lord with all of my soul, and so many times we're saying, Lord, bless me, bless me, bless me. But David said, I want to bless you. And that's what I'm talking about this morning. Are we pouring ourselves out? When you walk out those doors, are you satisfied with the praise that you gave him? And I don't find it a coincidence that they were singing, Holy, Holy, Holy. Man, let's pour ourselves out this morning. No tradition, no religion, ain't nobody in this room but you and God. Give it to him. Who cares who's watching? Praise his name. Bless his name.
Praise. Thank you. Oh, Thank you. with sin. Somebody's holding on too tight. You're holding on to the past too tight. Sin, you gotta release it. Wonder why you can't sleep at night. Wonder why you don't feel peace. Release that past. Let him fill that place with his love. Hear the word of the Lord. Say, this is the new day. Let it go.
Stop what I'm doing come to him with you were kicked. You did. As we noticed, the middle one here, when Michael passed by, got the microphone. He wore the microphone. He came up here to get it. I told him he couldn't have it. It hurt his feelings. What did he do? He started crying. The same thing we do as adults. Every time we ask for God for this or for that, or help me get this, help me get that, God says no. What do? We pout and we cry. Then what did Pastor Mike do? He does the same thing that God does. He reached down, picked up his son, and held him. The same thing that God does to us. Even if we get mad or our feelings get hurt or we feel like God's not listening or God's not paying attention, he reached down and picked up his son and held him. What did his son do? He felt safe. He knew that his daddy loved him. He was in his daddy's arms. The same thing that goes on when God puts his arms around us. Oh, we have a question.
God speaks. God speaks in numerous ways. He could send an angel if he wanted to. God speaks. Amen? If you walked out this building today, are you content in your praise? Did you pour it out on God? You don't have to answer. That's between you and God. Amen? I know it's getting a little hot in here. Man, I don't care. If we didn't have these seats, I'd be in here standing. And Maxine, you'd be standing too if we didn't have these chairs in here, wouldn't you? That's the truth of it. It's in this anointing, in this presence. Amen? Thank you, Jesus. Family that prays together, stays together. That's a beautiful thing. That is a beautiful thing. Amen. Now's the time. We've been pouring out. But now's the time to give back to the Lord. Now's the time that we give our tithes and our offerings unto God. And I ain't going to make a long speech out of it. Listen, you give what God tells you to give. And when it comes into this church, we know that it goes back out to the community. We know that for a fact. We know that this church has been under numerous attacks, and the reason why is because it's in the will of God. No weapon formed against us. I love how Pastor Jim says it. He says it doesn't say no weapon will form. It says no weapon that is formed against us will prosper. It says the gates of hell shall not prevail against this church. Amen. So I'm going to ask you guys to put on some music for a time to give back. What we've got here is the basket, is the tithes and offerings. The bare little bucket here is for the children's ministry. I apologize, there's no children's ministry this morning. Sandy called me about 8:30 this morning and said that she is in a lot of pain and she could not be here to open the children's ministry. So keep Sandy in your prayers. So we're seeing little kids running around, but hey, suffering not the little children to come. Let them come. Amen. Let them come. Also, we've got Greg over here. Greg has the square reader. If nobody's got cash, we also take the card for the tithes and offerings. Kind of a modern day church, but we still sanctified and we still under that new covenant of Jesus Christ. Amen. All right, so let's give our tithes and offerings unto the Lord. And that's not just now. That's always. That's always. Someone needs your ear, you give them your ear. Someone needs your shoulder, you give them your shoulder. That's our ties, our whole lives under God. Let's give. heart, please receive the offering that we provide for you, Lord, and that your kingdom, and that this will plant a seed in the community. Lord, it's not about sustaining the church. It never has been. It's about you, Lord, and what this money can do for your kingdom. Lord, we thank you in your name. Amen.
Amen. My wife took me out on a surprise date the other night. And when I say surprise, I mean she blindfolded me. And she drove me about 40 minutes with that blindfold on. And she took me to a lake just to watch a sunset. And she said, "You've got 3 kids at the house." She said, and she gives so much time to Levi and to Connor that we don't get that time together. And so she made it a point to take me on a date. And man, it was awesome. I'm talking about it was beautiful. And I can't ask for a better woman in my life. And it really shows how when God says, before the foundation of the world, I created you. I knew you before you were formed in your mother's womb. Because he knew what he was doing when he created my wife. He knew what he was doing when he put her in my life. And man, I thank God for it. But it really shows that God does have plans for our lives. Plans to prosper. Plans for our good. And then we've got to trust Him with all of our lives. Because listen, I was foolish back in the day. And I could have chose somebody that would not be nowhere near like my wife. I could have chose something that would have not been God's blessing for my life. So with that being said, 2 things. Slow down and trust God. He's in control. And with your obedience brings the blessing. It's what the Word of God says. Just trust Him. He's got plans for your life. And then secondly, we get so wrapped up in life. We got so wrapped up in the things going on around us that we neglect to take the time for God. My wife said a couple months ago, her and her sister were talking, and she told her sister, "I just really don't feel like I have time with the kids and everything that's going on in her life." She said, "I really don't feel like I have enough time in the day for God." And then God immediately rebuked her and said, "How can you tell the Creator of time that you don't have time for Him?" And there's so much truth.
We're given 24 hours a day. But let's take that time and spend it on God. Amen? Amen. Let's pray. Father, I thank you, Lord, for this beautiful, beautiful morning, God. Everything that you've been doing so far, God, and I thank you for the anointing that's in this place. I thank you for your spirit being here, God. I thank you, Lord, that there's worship that's taking place in this building, Father. Most importantly, worship that's taking place in our lives and our hearts, God. Thank you, Lord, that we were able to pour ourselves out on you, God. Thank you that you granted repentance for us, God, when it was, Lord, when we accepted you as Lord and Savior. And I thank you, God, that we continue to walk in that repentance, Father. Lord, I pray that everyone in this place you will use for your glory. And I pray that they will be bold enough, as Isaiah said, to say, send me, Lord. I'll be the one to proclaim glory to your name. So, Lord, use us. Send us, commission us, Father. Pour your spirit out upon us so we can be strengthened to perform your will. In Jesus' name, amen. Not too long ago, my wife and I, we moved from Gaffney, South Carolina to Spartanburg. And it wasn't something that was just a rash decision. It was something that we had been praying on for well over a year. We've been seeking counsel, and I felt like God was calling us to move, and we didn't know where we were going. I just really felt like God was saying to go. And so I wanted to follow God. And it got to a place where the more time that I was in Gaffney, I felt like I was in disobedience to God. And so we started looking around. I was looking for a place to live or work out in Charlotte, North Carolina. I was looking for places all around, Greenville, Spartanburg, just wherever God wanted to send us, because we just wanted to follow God. That's all we wanted to do. And it got to a place where we were sent here to Spartanburg. And so we moved here, and we're still asking God, Lord, what do you want to do? What do you want to do in our lives? Because before my wife and I ever got married, we knew that we were going to get married. And 3 days after talking to my wife, just 3 days after us getting to know one another, I heard God say, it's going to be your wife. 3 days. And so we courted for a year. We snuck off at times in that 1 year period just to hang out, you know, and we really just wanted to make sure it was God before we said I do. And when we found out it was God, here's what he told us. In my prayer time with the Father, he says, y'all will get married, but she needs to know that your marriage will be a ministry unto me. Now I want you to know, I'd only been saved a little bit over a year, year and a half. And so when God said your life is going to be a ministry, I didn't know exactly what he was talking about. But I told her that. And he kind of gave me this illustration. It says if you were to be a missionary to move to China, then she would have to learn Chinese to be able to go with you. So I'm saying that's all I knew, and it's all I understood. It was confirmed through a message by Francis Chan that I was listening to after my prayer with the Father. And so when my wife came over later on that evening, she's on the balcony, and I went up to her and I said, look, God is saying we're going to get married, but our marriage is going to be a ministry. And so we realized real quick, I think it was 6 months after we got married, God called us to start a church. And so we started a church in Gaffney, and it was just a couple months after that, God confirmed that we were to be a Matthew 25 ministry, which is to feed those who are hungry, to give drink to those who are thirsty, to give shelter to the homeless, to give clothes for those who are naked, and to visit those who are in prison. And listen, we took that serious. That's what we desired to do. It's what God laid on our hearts. And man, the way he confirmed it, I don't want to keep you here until this evening, because this message truly can. But just to make it a quick sermon, so to speak, we followed the call, and it got to a place where in Gaffney there was at times we had between 30 and 40 people in this building that we were using
that were there for the shelter, and they were there to get out of their addictions and to get a new life in Jesus Christ. And man, it was a beautiful, beautiful thing. And so when God was calling us out, all the work that we put into it, everything that we did to hold on to it, God was telling me the whole time, that was your Isaac. It's time to sacrifice. And listen, I didn't want to let go. I fought, and I took counsel for over a year, and I really didn't want to, but when God said go, we knew it was time to go. But we came here to Spartanburg, and you know, we didn't know what we were going to do. And one night, in prayer, I heard the Father say, the prodigal's home. When we moved from Gaffney, we brought bunk beds with us. We turned our house. The downstairs is for my wife and my family, but the upstairs is intended to be used for those who are coming out of addiction. And so we brought the bunk beds with us, and we knew that God was calling us into ministry again. We didn't know how it was going to work. It was like we were starting all over. And I don't know about you guys, but have you ever had to start all over? Listen, it wasn't easy, but we just wanted to trust in God. And like I said, in prayer I heard the Father say, the prodigal's home. And basically what he said, he says, the prodigal is home. All right, the prodigal is home. The prodigal's home. And then he also said, the prodigal has a home. This is a home for them to come to return to the Father. And so what I want to talk about this morning, can anyone guess it? Prodigal son. Amen. All right, so let's go. We're going to start in Luke chapter 15. It's up here on the screen if you don't have a Bible, and if you don't have a Bible, shame on you. I'm joking. It's up here on the screen. Then he said, a certain man had two sons. And the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the portion of goods that falls to me. And so he divided to them his livelihood. And not many days after, the younger son gathered all together, journeyed to a far country, and there wasted his possessions with prodigal living. But when he had spent all, there arose a severe famine in that land, and he began to be in want. And then he went and joined himself to a citizen of that country, and he sent him into his fields to feed swine. And he would gladly have filled his stomach with the pods that the swine ate, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have bread enough and to spare, and I perish with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Make me like one of your hired servants. And he arose and he came to his father. But when he was still a great way off, his father saw him and had compassion and ran and fell on his neck and kissed him. And the son said to him, Father, I've sinned against heaven and in your sight, and I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, bring out the best robe and put it on him, and put a ring on his hand and sandals on his feet. And bring the fatted calf here and kill it, and let us eat and be merry. For this my son was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to be merry. Now his older son was in the field. And as he came and drew near to the house, he heard music and dancing. So he called one of the servants and he asked what these things meant. And he said to him, your brother has come, and because he has received him safe and sound, your father has killed the fatted calf. But he was angry, and he would not go in. Therefore his father came out and pleaded with him. So he answered and said to his father, lo, these many years I've been serving you. I've never transgressed your commandment at any time, and yet you never gave me a young goat that I might make merry with my friends. But as soon as this son of yours came, who has devoured your livelihood with harlots, you killed the fatted calf. And he said to him, son, you are always with me, and all that I have is yours. It was right that we should make merry and be glad, for For your brother was dead and is alive again, was lost and is found. I was glad to read. All right, I've got some questions, and listen, I ain't talking to a dead church. Okay, I'm not talking to a dead church. So I've got questions. And see, what we've got to do, the Bible says, as iron sharpens iron, so one man sharpens another. So we're going to discuss this parable. And together, we're going to grow. Amen? I got a mumbled amen on this side and a quiet amen on this side. So we are going to grow together. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. When you hear this parable or when you read this parable, what's it about? I can't hear you. When you went out into the world. Okay, so it reminds you of your past, right? It reminds you of some things that you did, kind of finding your way, so to speak. Right? What else? What's some other ways that this parable speaks to? What's it about? It's about forgiveness. Right? When we go out and we do these things, we squander what God's given us. Right? We turn His blessings into curses. And listen, every single one of us is in here. We've done it sometime or another in our life. We've taken a gift from God and we've squandered it. We used it for wild living. And when God seen us coming back, saw us a great way off, and He still ran out. Kissed our name. And forgave us. What else? A grudge against your brother. If any man hates his brother, Scripture says that he has committed murder in his heart. Right? How can we say that we love God when we hate our brother? Right? That's what the Scripture says. What's that next thing? Jealousy of his brother. Envy.
Selfishness.
Not a father's love. Amen. Trust. Amen. And trust and forgiveness. Absolutely. To trust his father. To trust his father. He didn't know if his father was going to accept him back. Listen, we're not talking about today's society. Realize, we're talking 2,000 years ago. And we're talking about Israel. We're talking about Jerusalem. We're talking about where, at 13 years old, those boys are no longer boys, they're men. Humility and repentance. When that younger son said, "I want all of your possessions," he was really saying, "I don't want anything to do with you, your calling, this land that he was supposed to grow up and take care of his father's land according to the custom." Jared, it's so hard for me to take you serious with them glasses on. Okay, those are prescription glasses, so it's not like, you know, his future's so bright or anything. He's got a machine. But I always have to pick on Jared. My wife will tell you, I love him. But he was saying, "I don't want anything to do with you, Father. Give me everything that you got planned for me now. I want it." And the Father did it. The Romans chapter 1 says that God will do that. It says that if we want our sin bad enough, He'll turn us over to our sin. Right? And that's what the Son was saying. I want this. I'm the one. I want to take control of my life. No different than in the garden, what did the serpent tell Eve? "If you eat of this fruit, you will be like God." Right. I heard a sermon from a pastor out in Greenville, and he was talking about eating of the fruit. Right? And he said, "Curse is every man who hangs on a tree." And he said that that's the tree that we should be eating from. That's the fruit that we should be eating from, is the cross of Jesus Christ. Right? And so the devil told Eve, "You will be like God." What does the word Christian mean?
Like Christ.
Christ. Christ-like, like Christ. It was always God's intention for us to be like His Son. Right? We know the stories of being transformed, right, into Christ. We know the story of the removing the dross, the refiner's fire. And when he looks in and he sees his image, right, he knows that all the dross and everything's out. So it's always been about being in the image of Jesus Christ. Okay? Not that we will be gods, but we will be like His Son. And listen, there's not one selfish thing that Jesus Christ did when He walked this earth. Not one selfish thing. It was always about others. Amen? And so, going back to what he said, I want everything now. And he took it and he abused it. He wasted it. Listen, that was me. That was me without a doubt. God, I want to be God of my life. I want to live in all of it. Right? And I ended up just like that. I ended up in the pods with the pigs. I ended up in that pig pen with a lot of regret. But I thank God for grace. I thank God for the grace that He poured out on me. Because that grace allowed me to forgive myself, allowed me to forgive those that hurt me, and then also allowed those to forgive me that I hurt. Amen. That's His grace and that's His mercy. So, it's about the Father's love. It's about overcoming envy and jealousy. It's about our lives and the things that we've done, right? But did you know that even though both sons are at their father's house, nowhere in that parable does it say that either son is saved? Nowhere in that parable does it say either one of those children are saved. Who's the younger brother? The younger brother, the one that went out after the wild living, right? Is no different than that person that comes to the church after they've squandered everything, after they've ruined everything, and they come back seeking their Father. They come into the church and they're seeking that forgiveness of God. So who's the older brother? What did the older brother tell his father after he saw they were having a party? He's the one that stayed in the church. He's the one that he never left. He said, I've always been here with you. I never left. And you didn't kill a fatted calf for me. You didn't even give me a goat. Right? So in this parable, what Jesus is doing, see, I want you to see, let's see here, Luke 15, verse 1. It says, now all the tax collectors and the sinners were coming near him to listen to him. So who was coming near Jesus Christ to listen to his messages? Sinners, tax collectors, right? And it says, both the Pharisees and the scribes began to grumble, saying, this man receives sinners and eats with them. And so Jesus gives these parables. Jesus begins to speak in these parables. And so what you have here is you've got a younger son who is that sinner who is coming to listen to him speak, who's wanting to hear the message from Jesus, and then you've got the others who's always been in the synagogues, they've always been in the temples, and here they're saying, they're grumbling, look at this man, he sits with the sinners and the tax collectors. And so do you see the parable? Do you see the older brother and the younger brother? Do you see the one that says, I've always been here, and the one that says, I've squandered and I'm sorry? Right? And so that's what Jesus wanted to do. He wanted to open the eyes of the Pharisees. So who was the parable written to? Now we've got this younger brother who goes out and squanders everything, and he comes back and he's received back to the Father, right? But then you've also got this older brother. He says, I want nothing to do with you. Think about it. When the younger brother, when he was coming back, when the younger son was coming back, it says while he was still a great way off, the father ran to him, fell on his neck, kissed him, got his servants to get the robe and the sandals,
in the ring, and he embraced his son for coming home. The father went out and embraced his son. And then they throw this party. Everyone's having a great time because the son who was dead is back and he's alive again. And at this party, this feast or celebration, once again, the father has to go to another son. The son didn't come in and say, "I'm angry with you." He was so angry with the father, he would not even come in. And so the father has to go out to the older son and say, "Come into the party." He says, "No. You never did anything for me." And man, that's so many people. So many people, they begin to pray to God and they say, "God, if you do this for me, or if you do that for me, Lord, I'll..." And the thing of it is they're not wanting to bless the Father with their lives. Their whole relationship with God is, "If you do this for me, I'll serve you. If you do this for me, I will serve you." And what happens when God says no? Ain't that what Michael was saying? When God says no, we begin to cry and we begin to grumble and complain. And so the whole relationship is not a relationship with God, it's a relationship with yourself. See, and when God says no, have you ever met somebody that it just looked like they were in the will of God and they were in a relationship with God until something didn't happen that they wanted to happen in their lives? And what happens? They won't come into the celebration. And what's that celebration? What is that celebration? That celebration. Skip past that John and go to the Luke. Luke chapter 14, starting at verse 15, says, "Now when one of those who sat at the table with him heard these things, he said to him, 'Blessed is he who shall eat bread in the kingdom of God.' And then he said to him, 'A certain man gave a great supper and invited many, and sent his servant at supper time to say to those who were invited, Come, for all things are now ready. But they all with one accord began to make excuses. The first said to him, I bought a piece of ground and I must go and see it. I ask you to have me excused. And another said, I have bought 5 yoke of oxen and I'm going to test them. I ask you to have me excused. Still another said, I have married a wife and therefore I cannot come. So the servant came and reported these things to his master. And then the master of the house began being angry, said to his servant, Go out quickly into the streets and the lanes of the city and bring in here the poor and the maimed and the lame and the blind. And the servant said, Master, it is done as you commanded, and still there is room. And then the master said to the servant, Go out into the highways and the hedges and compel them to come in that my house may be filled. For I say to you that none of those men who were invited shall taste my supper." Do you see the parallel that he's given to the Pharisees here? There's a great feast that's thrown. There's a great celebration. And he says, go out and invite the lame, the poor, the maimed, the blind. Go and get those, the younger brothers, and invite them to come, because I want you to understand, God can use somebody that has went out and squandered things. And man, the scripture says it so much. It says, those who are forgiven much, love much. And so for those who, they go out and they've done things and they regret and they see the forgiveness of God and that grace of God, it shows how much he has forgiven them. And so they answer and they say, Lord, I will pour out my life for you. I will give my everything for you. You have my life. I surrender. Those are the ones that God says, now go. Proclaim my word.
but those who sat in a pew for 50 years and they said, I've always been in your church, I've always came, I was here every Sunday morning, Sunday night, Wednesday night, but all they do is sit in a pew. They can't be used by God because they have such bondage and fear on their life, and it's not about the relationship, but it's about the religion, and it's about the tradition, and it's the things that they were taught in Sunday school as a mere child that they hold on to all the way up until they lay on their deathbed. It's not about the religion, it's about the relationship. It's about Jesus saying, I want to use those, and the only ones that he can use. Man, I've seen so many people in what we do. I've had a man come to me and say, I went to a church, he was homeless. He said, I went to a church seeking help. He said, they called the cops on me. That church was full of older brothers. Their church was full of people that they looked down on the younger brother. They looked down in jealousy and envy. Seeing that a younger brother can be used by God and can be forgiven. But they're so alone. And that's the reason why religion kills. That's the reason why tradition kills. We can't hold to the things that, man, Matthew 15, why do you hold to the commandments of men as though they're doctrines of God? Why do we hold to the traditions of men as though they're doctrines of God? I got an amen from him. I think I got a little booger on it too. Does anyone understand what I'm saying here? It's like this. You're seeking after a relationship, so you pray more. You want that promotion at work, so you read your Bible more. You want a healing to take place in your body, so you go to church more. Is that a relationship with God, or is that a relationship with yourself? See, there's an ulterior motive behind it. There's a motive saying, God, if you do this for me, and I said it earlier, things like that, you'll receive giftings, but you'll always be empty. Because the anointing only comes to those who say, Lord, I know what I've done in my past. I know who I was, and man, I don't care how proper you are in here today. I don't care how good your life was or how bad your life was. Every one of us in this place has skeletons in our closet. Everybody in here has something that they are ashamed to speak of. And when you say, Lord, I know who I was. I know what I've done. And you come back home. You come back home. He will see you a way out. Man, and that's it. Listen. The father didn't go to a foreign country to his son. The Bible says, if we draw near to God, what will he do? Do you see the relationship? Understand that step that you take, that first step. Sorry, but my legs ain't this big. The Word of God says that the heavens cannot even contain how big the Father is. You take that one step, He takes one step. He takes one step. How big is that step? Because He desires you. He desires you. No matter what you've done, and no matter the things that's taken place in your life that you regret, no matter those skeletons in your closet, God desires you. If you draw nigh to Him, He will draw nigh to you. Another example was in John chapter 6, verse 26. Jesus replied to those, He had just fed the 5,000, and they're chasing after Him, they're following Him, and His reply is, truly, truly, I say to you, you are seeking me, not because you saw signs, but because you ate your fill of the loaves. So why were they following Jesus? Brandon, don't be having no baby in this place. I'm not playing.
Jesus, hold her off. Just a little while longer. Just till church is over. That's all my prayer is. Just till church is over. Don't be mad at me. Why were they following him? Because they were fed. Because they ate of the loaves and they were full. And Jesus told them, he knows why we're following him. He knows if we're following after him because we want something from him, or if we're following him because we want him. And there's a huge difference. Wanting the Father. Man, did you have peace in your heart during praise and worship? Was the troubles and the cares of this world, were they gone? Why? Peace of God was here. God was in our heart. The reason why is that's the reason why the scripture says, cast all your cares upon him, because he cares for you. The same peace that we had during praise and worship, we can have when we walk out of this world. No matter the trial, no matter the storm, even Jesus on the boat was sleeping when the waves and the wind was coming against the boat. Why? Because he already knew they were getting to the other side, and he knew the authority that he had. And listen, you've got authority in Jesus Christ. And so when those waves and that wind comes against you, Jesus gives a great example. He says, those who build their house upon the rock, that house will stand. When the winds and the waves come, that house will not be destroyed. But the foolish man who builds his house upon sand, it'll be destroyed. When the winds come and you're on that rock and you're founded, you've got peace. You know that God is in control. And the same peace that we had in here, in the presence of God, we can take that presence with us. And we can maintain that peace. Colossians says, let the peace of God rule in your hearts. The Amplified Version says, let the peace of God rule in your hearts. That word rule means as an umpire. Now, if you know anything about baseball, the umpire is the one that calls the shots. So basically it's saying, let the peace call the shots in your life. Let that peace rule your life. There's two other parables in Luke 15. Luke 15 verse 3 says, so he told them this parable, saying, what man among you, if he has 100 sheep and has lost one of them, does not leave the 99 in the open pasture and go after the one which is lost until he finds it? When he has found it, he lays it on his shoulders, rejoicing. And when he comes home, he calls together his friends and neighbors, saying to them, rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which was lost. I tell you that in the same way, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance. Jesus says, I did not come to seek and save those who are already saved. He says, I came to seek and save those which are lost, those who are sick. He says, for one who is well does not need a physician. And Jesus is known as the great physician. And so understand what he's talking about here, because he's speaking to the Pharisees. What he's saying here, he's saying, I tell you, there's more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than the 99 righteous persons. I've got it all together. I've got my life in order. No, your life is out of order. No matter how much you think you are in control of your life, that's the problem. You are in control of your life. It's kind of like saying, God is my co-pilot. You ever seen that? No, God is your pilot. Get out of the driver's seat. Right? And so he's telling these Pharisees, listen, it's better. There's more joy. There's a party in heaven when one sinner repents. The next one, it goes on and says, or what woman, if she has 10 silver coins and loses one coin, does not light a lamp and sweep the house and search carefully until she finds it? When she has found it, she calls together her friends and neighbors, saying, rejoice with me, for I have found the coin which I lost. These other two parables, what was lost didn't have to say to itself, I'm coming home.
the other two parables. See, all three of them were lost. The younger brother, the coin, the sheep. They're all lost. But the only parable is the parable of the prodigal child, where he has to come back on his own. It should have never been that way. See, God has us designed in a great commission to go out into all the world and make disciples. So whose job was it to go and bring that son home? Genesis chapter 4, verse 9. Then the Lord said to Cain, "Where is Abel, your brother?" He said, "I do not know. Am I my brother's keeper?" Whose job was it to go out and find that? His brothers. That parable should have said, and that's why he's telling the Pharisees, "You're grumbling and complaining because I'm sitting down with sinners and tax collectors. You're not enjoying a relationship with me because you're so angry that I'm going out to those who are sick, to those who are lost. They won't come into the feast because they're not going after their brothers." That's our calling. I don't care what somebody has done to you. I don't care how much in your heart you say, "I cannot forgive that person." You must. You do not have a choice in the matter. You do not have a right to say, "I thank God that Jesus on that cross said, I'm going to forgive everyone. I'm glad he didn't say, I'm going to forgive everybody but Michael. Look what Michael's done to me." Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. And listen, I'm pretty sure I'm talking to a bunch of younger brothers and younger sisters in this room that's went out and squandered things and did things in their past that they've had regrets of. I say had, because it's past tense. We're to forget about the things behind us and press onward towards that heavenly call, right? Forget those things behind us and move forward. That's our calling. But at the same time, sometimes because of religion and because of tradition, that younger brother or sister can turn into that older brother or sister. They can look and say, "Look what I've done with my life." Nebuchadnezzar said the same thing. "Look at all that I've accomplished. Look at all that I've done." God humbled that man for 7 years in the wilderness, living as a wild beast. It's not about what we've done. It's not about what we have or what we've attained. If you want to get technical, Philippians chapter 3 says, "Count everything as a loss or dung." It's not about what we've got. It's about who we have. And you know you've got him because he calls you out. He calls you out of your comfort zone. At times you might sit there and say, I feel comfortable here. I don't want to. Well, he's not going to stop pushing. He's not going to stop pushing. He's going to be in your face, in your ear. He's going to be nudging you on the back. He's going to do everything to get you. It's up to you. Take that step. But don't get caught up in religion and tradition and think that everything is okay. God cannot use someone that's got it all together. I ain't saying be a broken mess. I ain't saying go out and continue living in that squander. There's a balance. Realize whose you are. Not who you are, whose you are. Realize you're a child of the Most High God. And there are many, man, Leland in his song says it best, there are many prodigal sons on our city streets searching for shelter. Understand, you got friends, you got family, and you know the Word of God. You should know the Word of God. If anyone wants to be my disciple, Jesus said, you must continue in my Word. I was having a conversation with a guy yesterday. He had been 18 years in legalism, 18 years in religion. And he and I, we talked on the phone for well over an hour. And he started crying towards the end. He says, so many people that I preached hellfire and brimstone to. He says, I preached false doctrine. He says, and I have to stand before God on that. He had so many regrets of the religion and the traditions that he spoke. And God broke him loose of those bonds. And I just simply told him, God's faithful. God is faithful. God works all things out for the good of those who love him and are called according to his purpose. Do you love God?
Yes.
Are you called by God?
Yes.
Then he's going to work things out for your good. Now, in order to work things out for your good, you had to do something wrong. He's going to work it out. And so that man that preached hellfire and brimstone, I know that God is going to show the truth to those. Because if they're not listening to man, do not dare listen to a sermon preached by me. Do not dare listen to a sermon preached by me and take it at the full word of God. You take it to the word of God. You line it up with Scripture. And if it lines up with Scripture, then know the Holy Spirit will speak. But if it does not line up with Scripture, what do you think when you stand before God? If I taught a lie? Well, Pastor Michael, Lord, he told me this, and I know what he said was true. That's not going to be an excuse before an almighty God. Study to show thyself approved. A workman need not be ashamed, rightly dividing the word of God. Get in your word. We can't say we don't have time. Once again, can we say to the creator of time, I don't have time. Get into that word. Realize there are people out there that have squandered and wild living, and listen, they need Jesus just as much as we do. Don't hold yourself to that bitterness and that anger because of what they've done to you, because they need Jesus just as much as you do. It's time to let go. Let the prodigals come home. Let's not walk in our own self-righteousness. Our righteousness in the sight of God is what? Filthy rags. Give it to Jesus. Every bit of it. Spend your life, pour your life out for him. Decrease so that he can increase. Get out of his way. Get out of the driver's seat. Put him there. Let him have control of your life. Because look, man, if I'm in control of my marriage will fail. If my wife is in control of our marriage will fail. If I'm in control of my children, they will grow up to be that younger brother going out and wild living. But when I say, God, you are in control of my life, he will guide my steps for my marriage. He will guide my steps for my children. He will get me where he needs me to be because you have a divine path. It's a narrow path, is what the word of God calls it. A narrow gate, a narrow path. When you're in his will, you're walking that path. In every relationship, it will be reconciled. Every relationship will be strengthened. But we got to let go of self-righteousness. And we need to come out of that wild living. Bring it back to the will of God. See what this kid just did? He's done it twice. He's climbing these steps. Oh, get him, mama. Oh, you see all this up here? This is why we sit in the back. This is why we sit in the back, because we are slobs when it comes to our children. Our children are slobs, okay? But he just came up these steps and he accomplished something. When he got up to this step, immediately he rolls around and he looks at mama. He accomplished it. You and I, we don't even need that step. Some of us, we can just step right on up here. Understand there's growth in God. And for those new converts, when they do something like that, something small to us, something that we've already in our walk, we've already overcome, realize they're growing. Empower them. Strengthen them, speak life to them,
help them. We've got to get our focus off of ourselves, and we've got to put our focus on those in Christ Jesus. We've got to put our focus on those who need Christ Jesus. God tells us, he says, esteem others more higher than your own self, in the book of Philippians. Man, don't get caught up in that older brother generation. Take our eyes off of ourselves. Put our eyes upon the throne of God. Put our eyes on Jesus Christ. Set your mind on heavenly things. Let God lead your life, and I promise you, you'll begin to win those people to the Lord. Things in your life will start coming in order, and even when it seems like everything in your life is falling apart, you still know He's in control, and you've got peace. That's what I love about our relationship with Jesus. Let go of the traditions, let go of the religion. Trust Him. Have that relationship. You'll make one. Amen? Alright, now, I want to ask, what did God speak to your heart this morning? Passion and what? Compassion and understanding. What else? Forgiveness. Forgiveness. If you're holding on to bitterness, and if you're holding on to unforgiveness, you will not grow. Like I said, you will get a gifting, but you will not get an anointing. You've got to let it go. You've got to let it go. A gifting, you will look good in front of people, but you will be miserable on the inside. Walk in the anointing. Don't become the older brother. Yes, it's easy. Listen. Legalism is religion. Right, we've heard of people that say you got to have your hair cut a certain length. Some churches say you can't have a beard. Right, some churches say that women have to wear dresses down to their ankles and all these things. Right, the legalism. Right, but then you've got what is called that hyper grace, where you can do whatever you want, give however you want. The grace of Jesus Christ on that cross, what He poured out, is going to forgive you. You're good, and they both contradict scriptures. Okay, hyper grace and legalism, and listen. That thin, narrow wall. You can go into the hyper grace. You can go into the legal. You've got to stay in the will of God. Walk that narrow path. The steps of a righteous man are ordered by the Lord. Okay, I really felt compelled to say that. Any of us can. You can lose focus. When things get hard, you can convince yourself that it's okay, I can do these things, and you'll start wandering off into that hyper grace movement. Or you can get so hard on yourself for the things that you've done, and you can say, I can't do this anymore, I can't do that anymore, and you'll start making rules for yourself that God never even intended. Stay in that fine line. It's like a tightrope. One foot in front of the other. Amen. What else? Just a couple more things before we close. What is God saying to your heart? Don't hold a grudge. Stay humble. Amen. Trust Him. Amen. It is never too late to turn to God. I've got a woman that I love. She goes to a friend's church out in Gastonia. And she came to visit my dad in the hospital. And when she got there, she was just preaching to him, man. I mean, just preaching. And my dad loves the Lord, but she just felt compelled. She said, I was in religion for so long. She said, I was bound by the chains of religion. She said, I thought I had a relationship with God all those years. And when I was a little kid, when I was Levi's age, I remember going to church with her. So she had been in church all these years, and only a couple years ago, she got saved. Amen. And amen. She come out of that religion and into that relationship, and there's a new joy about this woman who spent all those years in church. Okay? You do not get saved by your church attendance record. It does not work. Okay? It's that relationship with God. Alright, one more thing. One more thing. Somebody give me one thing that God spoke to their heart. Love.
pay attention to your brother. Now, this is David. He speaks that because his brother was just under severe attack. His brother went from going out to places like downtown Greenville and Charlotte. I mean, he loved the Lord. He was on fire for the Lord. And there was a relationship that went wrong. He got upset with God. Right? And he did everything but denounce his relationship with God. And that man, his brother, went from being on fire to he started going to a mental institution, all kinds of things. This boy, his life was just going down. And I kept telling him, I said, it's like Nebuchadnezzar, God's going to bring you back to repentance. God's going to bring you back to repentance. This went on for over 6 months. He was afraid to even leave his house. He was afraid to be by himself. God showed him what life was like without him. And that's what death is. Death is not in the grave. Death is separation from God. He let him see what it was like to be without him. But then when that light came back on, his brother called me and he says, Michael, I'm back. You want to talk about shouting? He was back. Hallelujah. So you can always keep your eye on your brother. I beg you. Don't be so caught up in your own life that you forget those wrong.
Pastor Michael, make room for the prodigals.
I can't hear you.
Make room for the prodigals.
Make room for the prodigals. Amen. Be praying for our mission as well. We know that God's moving. We know that He's doing many wonderful things. It's a great thing to see people that were like myself. They come in fresh. They come in with all these things that seem to be going wrong in their life. And just like the Word of God says, what the devil intended for evil, God will use for good. And to see them grow. In the mornings before we work, we do something called a word of encouragement. And it's just sporadic. It ain't something that we plan. It ain't something we plan out. But it's just, Lord, speak. Speak to us. We'll address things that's on our heart. Do that every morning. You ain't going to be in a mission to do that. Do that with yourself every morning. Talk about what's on your heart. Get things off your chest so that these burdens don't weigh you down. Confess your faults one to another. And it's a beautiful thing seeing growth take place in their lives and mine as well. Okay? We're all growing. I mean, none of us in here attain. We're all still growing. Amen?
Yeah.
All right, let's pray. Father, this is a wonderful thing to be in this building with your saints. To be in here with those who have overcome many obstacles in their lives. And it's all because you strengthened them. They took that verse that says they can do all things through Jesus who strengthens them. And they took it literally. And you have performed so many miracles in their lives. You have taken out so much bitterness. You have healed so much pain. You have healed sickness in their bodies. They have tasted and they have seen that you are good. It's a great thing to be able to worship with them. But I know there's still some in here that have not quite tasted how great you are. And I pray, Lord, that they'll let down every guard. They'll lay aside every sin and hindrance, every weight. And they will step into that grace and that mercy. They will see your power. Father, we pray for a fresh anointing on every single one of us. Father, we pray for a fresh anointing on our lives so that at the workplace people will see you. So that when we know you're calling us to witness, we'll step out without fear. Father, these are your children, this is your city, this is your church. Send us, God, and use us for your glory. God, thank you for speaking to our homes. Thank you for proclaiming your love to us, Lord. Even while we were still sinners, you died for us. Thank you. You're worthy in Jesus' name. Amen. Love you guys.